We see his name at the beginning of the first 9 James Bond films. Harry Saltzman, a man with a genius for making things happen. A man who, with his partner, Albert Broccoli, succeeded where others before had failed, bringing Ian Fleming's creation to the big screen.
Who are you?
Bond. James Bond.
Harry was a real showman.
The razzmatazz and everything.
Harry was very much a showman.
Harry always thought big. I mean, everything was sort of larger than life.
He was a great showman.
He never told us anything about his own mother, who I was named, that's my middle name, Dora. But I know that she died young. And I know that he ran away from home when he was about 15.
He was owned a circus at the age of 17 in Canada.
World War II finds Harry Saltzman in France, but his activities prove hard to pinpoint.
Harry was in the transport department of the Canadian Army.
He ended up working, or in the war with the RAF, and was in Paris.
He was a field officer, as we would say in England. I think it was something to do with intelligence.
He worked definitely for the OSS, and he had a role that was never really fully described to me, but made him work in a clandestine capacity.
He had a fund of wartime stories.
He had an incredible group of friends that were writers and theatrical agents in Paris at that time, and that's where he stayed, and that's where he met my mother, who had escaped from Romania during the war with her family.
He married a woman who was based in Paris.
Whenever people wanted an act or wanted to get a group together or wanted to cast a film or wanted to cast television, apparently he was always the man they contacted. He was always able to find their man, always find their act, and he was a go-between between various different mediums.
But times are hard for the fledgling showman.
He would live in different people's hotel rooms, sometimes even in their bathtubs in their hotel rooms, just constantly trying to keep things going.
In 1956, Saltzman produces his first movie, The Iron Petticoat.
This was one of his first films. I think that was his taste of what he wanted to do.
Saltzman soon forms Woodfull Productions with director Tony Richardson and playwright John Osborne.
Harry came to London and made Look Back in Anger.
He always thought that some of the best scripts came from the theatre.
My father, I think, was an incredible visionary and creative person.
And he'd realised that very few people would actually go to see a play, and the way to take a play and make it seen by more people, which is a medium he felt was underviewed and underappreciated, was by going to films.
The landmark film introduces a new genre, the kitchen sink movie.
He always felt that the films that he made during Woodfall were seminal. They gave him the direction, and there were films he brought him tremendous joy that he made.
Though critically acclaimed, the films are not very rewarding financially, and Saltzman's family is growing.
When I was born, my father was poor.
Just didn't have a great clue about money and would spend as it came, and so he never had anything in his pocket, really.
Desiring to make something more profitable, Saltzman takes out an option on the popular 007 spy novels of Ian Fleming.
There was a lot of trouble in arranging it all, a lot of financial risk.
People were a bit wary of his entrepreneurial skills.
Harry had had the rights and Covey had joined him.
Harry didn't want to sell the option. He wanted to become a partner. So that's how that partnership started.
I think best marriages are made from opposites, not likes. And I think that they each brought to me,
although they were different personalities, they still managed to get together and make films. Because they were both enthusiastic about Bond.
They got very excited and built up by each other at the time.
I think they both brought a lot to the party.
We both, I feel, contributed towards the making of the Bonds through our ideas in the films.
Cubby and Harry were a marvelous team for many reasons. They were both creative, they were both innovative, they were both very good businessmen, and they really, truly worked well together.
I'm sure they had a very interesting partnership.
Cubby and Harry represented a relationship that was based on two opposing points of view of reaching the same objective.
Clearly they shared a vision, and clearly they knew what they were doing.
Harry was, I think, it's true to say, a very necessary part of the original company.
He had a definite affination for Ian Fleming and a big excitement and love of what he was doing.
They understood the Bond books. They understood the kind of films we hoped they would make, and they made them.
They sparked off one another, and I think, the pairing succeeded.
Between 1960 and 1965, they got rich, both rich from a perspective of money, but also from the ability to become powerful in the motion picture business.
They made terrific movies. I think they were an odd combination of personalities.
Harry could be quite amusing, and he had a lot of energy, and he liked to do six things at the same time, or he became very restless. And Cubby was quite different because he loved the project at hand, and he put all his energy into that.
Cubby and Harry were like pick and pleck, but they were a great combination. They really were. Cubby was the soothing factor, and Harry was the fireball.
I remember Cubby as being the cuddly one and Harry being the tough one. But he was lovely, and they had a very dry sense of humour. I liked him awfully, I must say.
They were completely different.
Cubby was very contained and focused, and Harry was just all over the place.
Some people walked in awe of Harry.
I thought he had a legendary temper, but it was an extremely short fuse.
He lost his temper a lot. He exploded. Had these mad sort of outbursts.
And the word for Harry was volatile.
Harry Saltzman was a person who, if he felt you were not doing everything you should, he made it very well known, and he could really blow up at you.
By the time everyone was really upset, he'd actually forgotten what he was upset about.
He'd forget about it, totally. And they didn't.
He has a huge wake. He had a huge wake. He'd go through a harbor, and the ripples go out.
If people didn't give in to him, if you like, he was a pussycat.
I don't know if you say his bark was worse than his bite, but he was lovely, and you always knew where you stood with Harry.
Harry used to blow hot and cold, you know, but that was his character.
There would be script meetings or whatever with Guy and Tom and Ken Adam at Tilney Street, and at 6 o'clock, everybody would leave. And I remember saying to Harry, where are they going? And he said, well, they're going home. And I looked out of the window, and they were all going over to Cubby's office to have a drink.
Cubby was much more one of the boys.
And I said, you know what, maybe it would be a good idea if we got some booze in here.
The phenomenal popularity of the Bond films allows Saltzman to live and dress like a king.
He always wore the most bizarre sort of outfits. I mean, really bizarre.
Harry used to wear red socks, and he was very flamboyant.
His socks were loud, but he always wore a jacket.
My father always used to have a panky here. One for show, one for blow, you know?
He used to come into the office in little sort of yellow banana suits, we used to call them, with matching hats, and or bright scarlet ones.
Success also allows him to buy a dream home.
We had a house in the country, which I really have very strong memories of, called Woodlands Park.
It was the one place where I saw my father really relax.
I call it like a castle, but it was a wonderful mansion.
He would always invite the new ladies over, and my mother used to say, you know, my mother was also very involved in the kind of like, is she cute enough? Is she right enough?
He had a swimming pool upstairs. The top of the house, like the penthouse part of the house, the swimming pool was up there.
My father had a penchant for doing deals from the swimming pool. And he had this kind of like armchair with floats. And he'd sit there, and writers and editors and people would have to come out to the swimming pool. And he'd hold his meetings in the swimming pool. My father couldn't swim, by the way.
I remember swimming in his swimming pool and having dinner with him and his family.
We'd always have them over for dinner, and my mother would watch how they ate. Do they eat?
They had a lot of people come all the time, and we loved it. We would wake up in the morning, go running into my parents' room and say, who's coming today?
Before they announced me, I used to go out there. I'd stay one night with Cubby and one night with Harry, because they were getting to know me to see who this guy was.
When I was a little guy, I used to have a big crush on George.
I remember hearing one morning, James Bond, James Bond. And I woke one eye, I said, I'm dreaming. What's going on? James Bond. I look out the window, it's Harry calling his two dogs. One is James and one is Bond, these two German shepherds.
We had go-karts, we had mini mokes from the films. Johnny Steers, who did all the special effects, created my train set. My father said, I've got something to show you. Have something for your birthday. And on the wall, there was a little box. And I opened the box. He said, here's the keys. I opened the key. I opened it. And there was two buttons. He says, well, press it. So I pressed the green button. And all of a sudden, from the ceiling, came down and landed right on top of the ping pong table, this most extraordinary train set. With all the villages and everything done, absolutely perfect. But it wasn't done like it by an amateur, it was done by professional modelers.
I spent a lot of time outside with the horses. He was inside with the train set.
He used to have people down for lunch every Sunday and stay for the weekend.
There was always people like Roger Moore and Michael Caine.
Maurice Binder, sometimes Ken and Letizia Adams.
We used to have a minor bird, and the minor bird was in the room where the poker table was.
He would, you know, respond and repeat to the different terms that they were using during the poker games.
He would swear like Michael, or he would swear like Robert Wagner.
He was quite a naughty bird.
Full house. You could say that in Michael Caine's voice, full house.
Often when we would wake up on a Monday morning to go to school, they would still be playing the poker.
My father was like a Hollywood mogul living in England.
He'd have the best wines that you could possibly imagine in the wine cellar, and you go down there and you say, you pick a wine. Well, I only knew beer. And I'd pick one out and he'd say, oh yes, this is Rothschild's, da, 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 da. This is about 800 pounds, this bottle, but we'll have it for dinner.
Dining out with Swartzman, however, sometimes left his guests hungrier than when they arrived.
Harry had a habit of complaining about food in restaurants and food on location. In fact, Harry had a habit of complaining.
Harry didn't like to order food, or just order food. He liked to send food back. Not necessarily with the approval of those people who were just about to have their first bite.
A whole bunch of people were at a table in Finland, and the food came. The food was atrocious. And my father sent everybody's food back. Gert Froby from Goldfinger was particularly upset. He says, do you mind if I eat my food? And he goes, no, it's terrible. It sends everybody's food back.
You'd get the chef out to the table and, I mean, embarrass everybody. No problem for Harry.
He would send things back and keep sending them back.
But somehow you couldn't help liking him because what he was complaining about was real. I mean, the food was off or something was wrong.
I think it was Cubby who said, if Harry had been at the Last Supper, he'd have sent that back too.
Coming from such humble beginnings, he really enjoyed to live life to the fullest in every capacity.
One day we're in the rolls and the ashtray's full. I said, the ashtray's full. And I said, Harry, you've got to get rid of it. It's a joke. And he said, the chef said, get rid of this car next week. Give me a new one. Just like that. You know, the Rolls Royce. I was just joking. But he was like that, Harry.
I think he understood that he needed to have that showmanship.
Harry was one of a kind.
You don't realize there's any other world. You're in this world. You grew up as a child of these people.
They were my parents' friends. It was Uncle Roger, Uncle Sean.
He would always sign autographs for me that I could flog at school. Roger was better because I was older then and the price went up.
One of my girlfriends walked into the living room and Sean Connery was there and Peter Sellers was there and I think even Mick Jagger and a large group of London celebrities, and she walked into our living room and fainted dead away.
Some people sell biscuits, other people... My father makes movies.
But not just any movies.
My father would constantly doodle. And I said, what are you doing? He said, I'm thinking of another way to die. Dad would say, death is really quick. You know, bullet to the brain, you're dead. But what I've got to do is I've got to think of something glamorous. You've got to die Hollywood style. He said, you know, piranhas, electrocution. And it's got to look beautiful, it's got to look graphic, and it's got to give the audience a sense of revenge. He loved sharks. He thought that was great. If you see, a lot of sharks were used in Bond.
He loved coming up with all kinds of interesting gadgets and great scenes, and he'd tell them in the most enthusiastic way.
The first time I met Harry Saltzman, I was tremendously intimidated. Harry could be a real firecracker. He said, now listen, just let's get right to it. He said, what's the threat in this movie? And I said, well, Harry, the threat is that unless Blofeld gets paid, he's going to destroy the world. And Harry said, it's not big enough.
He thought huge picture, not just big picture. I mean, huge picture.
Harry always had good ideas all the way through. Some of them mad.
For example, say there was a line saying, Bond looks at the map on the wall. Harry would sort of jangle his coins in his pocket and say, why not let's put the map on the floor, make the floor the map.
Harry loved to stir things up. He was immensely bright, very quick. And he would always be racing far ahead of you.
He was a real, real rough diamond. I mean, very bright in many ways, and a real kind of circus kind of a guy, and I mean that in a complimentary way.
He wanted Bond to walk into a spin dryer.
You're joking.
Every picture would start with Harry saying, let me even get the spin dryer in there.
If it wasn't an elephant stampede, it was James Bond in a washing machine. I mean, it was just... That's typically Harry.
Harry was more of an ideas man.
8 out of 10 of those ideas were crazy. I mean, they were just, you know, everybody used to say, oh, my God.
He was a guy who had a tremendous talent for selling ideas, enthusiasm.
But 2 out of 10 would be terrific ideas.
Always excited by what he was doing, always on to the next step.
I can just tell you straight up, my father had an attention span problem.
His concentration was appalling. I mean, he would be in the middle of a fairly serious meeting with whomever and suddenly start jangling his coins and talking about something else.
He got bored quickly, and I think that if you think how that translates to something that's exploitable and useful, is that he was very focused on the attention span of an audience.
Harry was a very absolute stickler for tempo. He insisted that the shows went in what he called humps. And the last one was the big hump, which was the big blow-up.
Unless it just didn't keep coming at you and it didn't keep engaging you, you would be bored.
That's the Bond formula.
But I think Harry was very good at understanding all the characters that went into it.
You retired to England, I suppose?
No, I spotted a little island in the Bahamas. I'll hang up a sign, no trespassing, and go back to nature.
We used to go to the Cannes Film Festival every year. It was my mother's birthday, May 22nd, so there was always a huge party there. Part of what powered my father was my mother, without question. And everything he did for her. One of the letters that I found from him to her was when they were first married, and he had promised her the moon, basically. He had promised her jewelry, and he'd promised her a wonderful life, but he hadn't achieved that yet, so he drew it on this letter to her on their first anniversary, and he drew her the pictures of what he would one day get for her and purchase for her and give to her in her life.
Harry Saltzman is on top of the world, but restless by nature, he begins looking for other projects to produce, which strains his relationship with his business partner.
He was involved in lots of things, and Cubby was focused totally on Bond.
Harry in particular was very much involved with other projects besides Bond, and I know that Cubby Broccoli felt that James Bond was enough on one's plate to be a full-time job.
I think in his mind that he probably thought that the Bond films would pave the way for him to go back to doing the type of films that he really enjoyed.
The attraction of doing the Ipcrest file, Billion Dollar Brain and Funeral in Berlin, was that kind of could go back to that genre, the anti-hero, the you know, it wasn't very clean, it wasn't very pleasant, it wasn't very slick.
Harry really thought this was just the start of something enormous. You know, Bond, okay, most successful franchise, fine. That's the base on which I'm going to build, you know, you name it.
He wanted to be a great sort of businessman as well as a film producer, I think.
He really was an empire builder, Harry.
Cubby was very happy just producing the Bond films. Harry wanted an empire.
He looks at this world and wants it all.
This money that he had, which would anyone would consider to be a fabulous amount of money, was his grubstake on the way to the lever that would make him an international fortune.
Unfortunately, he started to go into lots of areas and beyond his scope, and he just became got in over his head financially.
He was then involved with Technicolor and a French camera company called Eclair Debris.
He was interested in taking over Technicolor. He was interested in doing other things and making other films.
My father didn't have the business acumen to be involved in a listed company. He was eaten alive.
I think probably his greatest strength was his greatest weakness, which is that he could talk anybody into anything, including himself. And that's probably where he came into trouble, because he would be so enthusiastic that he'd talk himself into something that was probably not a good investment.
The question always was how to finance the dreams. And he had one franchise that was paying for everything.
Harry had a lot of loans that were being called in by Swiss banks, and he was in a tight spot.
During that period, my father was frustrated because all the things he wanted to do, he couldn't do. He had financial problems. He had legal problems.
The business side of things were falling apart. He was in huge debt, scrambling to try and get out of trouble.
In 1975, just 15 years after optioning Ian Fleming's books, Harry Saltzman sells his share of the Bond partnership to United Artists.
Quite often happens in successful marriages, and I mean in profitable marriages and profitable partnerships, that something goes wrong. It was very difficult because I had been friends with both of them.
Saltzman also has problems closer to home.
Jackie was very ill. Harry was very preoccupied. And I don't think he was concentrating very much.
She was ill with cancer, and she was diagnosed and told when she was diagnosed that there was no hope for him.
I felt very sorry for him during that period.
It was a very, very dark period. He wasn't happy. And he got depressed. He got very clinically depressed. I think it was just all too much.
The tax laws changed in England. We sold our house.
We moved into St. Petersburg in 76. We had a house there from 75, but we moved full-time in 76.
My mother's sister lived in St. Petersburg, Florida.
I went to college in Florida, and my sister and my brother went to high school in Florida.
I stayed in touch with Harry Saltzman. I liked him.
A few of his friends, you know, Michael Caine was very loyal to him.
With all his, you know, producer's attitude, he was nice.
After we moved to Florida, at least once or twice a year, George would call my father and talk to my mother and see how she was doing. He really cared about my parents.
Jackie's health continues to decline.
He was then knew that Jackie was not going to make it.
That deflated him enormously and destroyed his ability to really see or understand what he was doing.
Jackie sadly died during the third of my bonds. Very tragic.
I think that was the start of Harry's decline. I think his health declined after that.
After my mother died, my father was a very, very lost man.
When For Your Eyes Only has its London premiere, Topol makes a suggestion to Cubby Broccoli.
I said to Cubby, have you invited Harry?
He invited my father, and my father asked me to attend with him. And it was the most wonderful moment, because he had become so destroyed by my mother's death. They hugged and held hands, and there was no animosity between them at all. It had been a business animosity, but not a personal one. And you could feel the relief between the two men.
I was very, very happy that, and I'm sure that everyone was, that they made it up.
I felt the happiness between them, that they both understood each other, that there was no bad feelings between the two. And it was a very, very special moment.
Harry Saltzman produces two films after leaving the Bond series, Nijinsky and Time of the Gypsies. He also returns to his first love, the theatre. On September 29th, 1994, at the age of 78, Harry Saltzman dies of a heart attack. But his films endure.
But I definitely think the Bond films are his legacy.